an expository study of the Bible at the Deeper Life Bible Church offers you an enriching study spiritual growth, thus opening your eyes to God's own way of righteousness. In this case, you will have the opportunity to listen to one such enriching Bible study. So prepare your heart to be blessed.
Let us pray. Father, as we come before you tonight, we ask you that you speak to every one of us from your word through your spirit in Jesus' name. We're praying that the application of your word to our lives will draw us closer to you, make us richer in the things of the spirit, and make us to be able to stand by faith in obedience to you according to your word in Jesus' name. Bless us and make us channels of blessings to other people around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Tonight in our Bible study, we're studying Psalm 50. It's a psalm of instruction and correction. God, through the psalmist, is speaking to nominal professors of religion concerning their ways of life, and he reveals the folly of placing empty religious practices above his redemptive plan and above the practical godly living that is revealed in his word. The judgment of God against all ungodliness is hereby brought to focus. As we look at this psalm, we're going to touch on three subheadings. Number one, the revelation of God's majesty, or the revelation of God's might and power. Number two, rejection of God's Messiah. Number three, rebuke for godless manners. Number one is the revelation of God's majesty, his might, and his power. I'm reading from Psalm 50 from verse 1. The mighty God, even the Lord, has spoken and called the earth from the rising of the sun unto the going down thereof. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God has shined. Our God shall come and shall not keep silence. A fire shall devour before him, and it shall be very tempestuous round about him. He shall call to the heavens from above, and to the earth, that he may judge his people. Gather my saints together unto me, those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice, and the heavens shall declare his righteousness, for God is judge himself. From the beginning to the end of the Bible, God's revelation to man tells us about the might or the majesty of the powerful Creator, his majesty or might, his power is seen everywhere and in everything, and he manifests his power in dealings with various kinds of men. For sinners, he manifests his power. For saints, he manifests his power. For sinners, he manifests his power to draw them, to convict them, to work miraculous wonders in their lives, so that will lead them to repentance. On the other hand, if his mighty work of power does not lead them to repentance, then he brings his power to be so heavy upon them that will lead to the judgment or the punishment of wickedness of the wicked. On the other hand, for the believer, for the saint, he manifests his power that he will draw them closer to himself. He will transform them. He will make them righteous, and he becomes their mighty deliverer. If you look at this from verse 1, it talks about the mighty God who has spoken, and he has called the earth into existence. Not only that, he has called the earth from the rising of the sun until the going down thereof. This reveals the power, the might, the greatness of God. As we have sung, how great thou art, how great thou art. And he has manifested his power from the foundation of the earth in creating and bringing everything that we see and know out of nothing. In Hebrews chapter 11, this power is revealed or spoken about. Hebrews 11 verse 3. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Out of nothing God brought forth everything. Out of nothing, He created all we can see, all we handle, all we behold and love, because He's a great, mighty, creating God. In 1 Chronicles chapter 29, the power of the Lord is also spoken about. 1 Chronicles 29 verse 12, both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all, and in thine hand is power and might, and in thine hand it is to make great, and to give strength unto all. You can see, if you are a believer, and you understand the power of God, He will make you strong when you depend upon Him. He changes your weakness for His strength, and He manifests His great power or His might in your very life. If you will depend upon the Lord, your weakness will be turned into strength when you have faith in the creative or creating God. Job chapter 26. Job chapter 26. Again, the power of God is here revealed and celebrated. From verse 9, He holdeth back the face of His throne, and spreadeth His cloud upon it. He has compassed the waters with bounds, until the day and night come to an end. The pillars of heaven tremble, and are astonished at His reproof. He divideth the sea with His power, and by His understanding, or by His wisdom, He smiteth through the proud. Here, the writers of the Bible, the new God, as a great God, a mighty God, a powerful God, a God that is high in holiness and majesty. And the more you know the Lord, the more you come near unto the Lord, the more you know how great, how powerful, how mighty the Lord is. In fact, the more you know the Lord, the more you will not be afraid of anything that happens in life. Because the Bible says, underneath you are the everlasting arms. He knows you. He loves you. He upholds you. Because He is a great God. And He is a powerful God. In Psalm 115. Psalm 115 verse 3. But our God is in the heavens. He has done whatsoever He has pleased. Talking about the power of God, there is nothing beyond His power. That's why the New Testament says, with God, all things are possible. He has done whatsoever has pleased Him. And so, the psalmist in verse 1 that we have read, talks about the might, the majesty, the power, the greatness of God. Let's come back to Psalm 50 verse 2. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God has shined. Now the psalmist picked up a particular place where God has deliberately, distinctively manifested His power. As you look at the Bible, you will see very many places where the Lord has manifested His power. In the Garden of Eden, He manifested His power. And He gave provision to men, to Adam and Eve, all that they will ever need. Although when they sinned, they had to be driven out of the Garden of Eden. At the burning bush, God manifested His power to His servant Moses. In Egypt, God manifested His power, His greatness and His majesty. The same thing He did at the Red Sea. But eventually they settled in the land of Canaan. And Jerusalem became the capital of the land of Israel. And Zion was a part of Jerusalem, where David was enthroned and where he established his kingdom. And here we are told, out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God has shined. As we look at the whole world, there is ugliness in the world. There is darkness in the world. There is confusion in the world. And yet, it appears that God showed His favor, His special favor unto Zion. And it says, Zion became the perfection of beauty. How did that happen? Because God shined in Zion. It became the perfection of beauty. When you give your life to the Lord today, and God comes into you, in His might, in His power, in His majesty, and it shines out of you. He also makes your spiritual life beautiful. All things pass away. Darkness passes away. Confusion passes away. And out of your heart too, the perfection of beauty will shine forth. 1 John, the first epistle of John, chapter 1, verse 5. This is talking about the attribute of God, telling us that God is light. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. This then is a message which we have heard of Him, and declare unto you, that God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. Verse 6. If we say we have fellowship with Him, and walk in darkness, we do not the truth. Verse 7. But if we walk in the light, as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanseth us from all sin. You can see here that the Lord God of heaven is light. There is no darkness in Him. All men have been blinded or blindfolded by the devil, the god of this world. He makes sinners live in darkness. But when you turn away from sin, away from Satan, and away from all your selfish ambition, and you take the Lord as your personal Savior, God becomes your Father. Jesus becomes your Savior. And then as God shone through Zion, and it became the perfection of beauty, He also comes within you, and He shines in the gospel light. God, who is light, He begins to shine through you. You become born again, your life becomes different. You become the light of the world, and you let your light so shine, so that people will glorify your Father who is in heaven. Although that's not the end. After you have been born again, there is a possibility of being sanctified. And when you are sanctified, you are so cleansed, you are so perfected, and you are so purified, that out of you will shine the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Isaiah chapter 60, verse 20. Isaiah 60, 20. Thy sun shall no more go down, neither shall thy moon withdraw itself. For the Lord shall be thine everlasting light, and the days of thy mourning shall be ended. Let's go back to Psalm 50, reading from verses 3 and 4. Our God shall come, and shall not keep silence. A fire shall devour before Him, and it shall be very tempestuous round about Him. He shall call to the heavens from above, and to the earth, that He may judge His people. I told you earlier that God manifests His might and power, His majesty and greatness upon sinners and upon saints, upon unbelievers and upon believers. The way God manifests His power is first to manifest His power in working miracles, or healing the sick, or delivering, or making provision, or doing some wonderful things, even for sinners. Why will He do that for a sinner? Because He wants to draw the sinners to repentance through those miracles, through those deliverances, and through those healings. You have known in our church here how God has delivered people, has healed people. Sometimes these people are still sinners. You say, why will God manifest His greatness, His majesty, His power and might upon sinners? The reason He does that is that He will draw them or call them to repentance. Romans chapter 2. Romans chapter 2 and in verse 4. Or despisest thou the riches of His goodness and the forbearance and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance? You see, that is the very reason why God will manifest His power in a positive way to heal, to deliver, to provide, to protect a sinner or a group of sinners or a family of sinners in a miraculous way. So that by that miracle, by that deliverance, He is manifesting His majesty and greatness to draw the people unto repentance. And if God has worked in your life like that, Remember that God is performing all those things, manifesting His power, His might, His greatness, His majesty, to draw you unto repentance. What if after experiencing the might of God, the greatness of God, the goodness of God, the sinner does not repent? Then judgment will come. We're told in the New Testament that Jesus Christ rebuked or upbraided the cities where He had performed great miracles. And the reason He rebuked them is because when they saw all those miracles, they did not repent. He expected that the miracles would have turned them to repentance. And the Lord is expecting today, if He has manifested His power on your life, that the goodness of God, His forbearance, and His miracle working power will lead you unto repentance. But what if, after you have seen His miracle power, after He has touched you, after He has healed you, after He has delivered you, what if you do not repent? Then He manifests His power, His greatness, His majesty in judgment. In Psalm 18. Psalm 18. Reading from verse 12. At the brightness that was before Him, a thick cloud passed, and hailstones and coals of fire. The Lord also thundered in the heavens, and the highest gave His voice, hailstones and coals of fire. Yea, He sent out His arrows and scattered them, and He shot out the lightning and discomfited them. Then the channels of waters were seen, and the fountains of the world were discovered at Thy rebuke, O Lord, at the blast of the breath of Thy nostrils. And so you will see over here that God many times will manifest His power for us to draw you to Himself, to convict you of your sin, to make you turn away from your evil, to make you embrace His plan of redemption. But if on the long run you reject the mercy of God, if on the long run you refuse to repent, then He can manifest that same power and bring judgment very heavily upon the rebellious sinner. In Psalm 50 verses 5 and 6. Psalm 50 verses 5 and 6. Gather my saints together unto me, those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice, and the heavens shall declare His righteousness. For God is judge Himself. Selah. The word Selah here means pause and think about this. And there's a lot to think about here. The Lord calls some people saints. He said, gather my saints unto me. How did these people who were sinners before, how did they become saints? How did the unrighteous people become righteous? How did unholy people become holy? How did people that were far away from the Lord before, how did they come near unto God? How did they become saints of God? Saints unto God. And now He said, gather my saints together unto me. He explains in that verse 5, those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. There is none that is good enough to become a saint on his own. The only way you can become a saint, a righteous one, a person reconciled unto God, a holy one, is to have covenant with God by sacrifice. And for us, on this side of the cross, it is the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ. Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Even for people in the Old Testament, although they lived at a time of a system of sacrifices, the Lord expected that they will look up and they will look forward to the future, to the perfect sacrifice that was to come. Because as they sacrificed every year, there was a remembrance made of sin. And they were pointing to the time when the perfect sacrifice, when the perfect substitute, when the Holy Son of God, when the appointed Messiah, the Christ, will come. And they were looking forward by faith. But then there were people that didn't look forward by faith. They depended upon the ritual, the ceremony, and the sacrifice alone. But for us today, we must look up to the Lord Jesus. He is the sacrifice. He is the propitiation for our sin. In John chapter 10, verse 11. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. Verse 14. I am the good shepherd. I am known, and I know my sheep, and I am known of mine. Verse 15. As the Father knoweth me, even so know I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Verse 17. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it again. That talks about the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Today, the way you become a saint of God is that you will believe on the perfect sacrifice, on the Lord Jesus Christ, on the Messiah, on the one who has died for you to take away your sins. And then God says, gather my saints unto me, those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. When you become born again, then you gather unto the Lord. You come unto the Lord. You fellowship with the Lord. Do you know there are people that say they are born again? They never gather before the Lord. On a Monday Bible study like this, they never come. On a Thursday when people of God gather together, they never come. On a Sunday when people of God worship the Lord, they never come. They are separated from the body of Christ. They are separated from the worshippers that are worshipping in spirit and in truth. But God says, I want you to come near. I want to delight in your presence and fellowship. I want you to always gather together with my saints, with children of God, with other people that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. But there's another thing here. The children of Israel misunderstood the point of the sacrifice, and the Lord had to rebuke them for it. That leads us to the second point, rejection of God's Messiah. Rejection of God's Messiah. You might say, Christ had not come at their own time. That is true. God wanted them to bring the sacrifices to Him, pointing to the Messiah, having faith in the coming Messiah. Even though they had not seen Him, even though He had not come, He wanted them to place their faith in that ultimate sacrifice, in that absolute sacrifice, in that perfect sacrifice. For us today, Christ has come. He has died. He was buried. And He was raised from the dead. And even though we have not seen Him in the physical or in the flesh, we are to place our faith, our confidence, our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, who has died for us already. The children of Israel brought sacrifices to the Lord. Without faith, without obedience, without humility, without submission to the will of God. And God rejected their sacrifices. And yet He said, you make covenant with Him by sacrifice. For that sacrifice to be acceptable, you come in obedience to His word. You come repenting. You come in humility. You come in submission to the will of God. You come in faith to the redemption plan. Let's look at it now from verse 7. Psalm 50 from verse 7 unto verse 15. Hear, O my people, and I will speak, O Israel, and I will testify against thee. I am God, even thy God. I will not reprove thee for thy sacrifices or thy burnt offerings. So I have been continually before me. I will take no bullock out of thy house, nor he goes out of thy folds. For every beast of the forest is mine, the cattle upon a thousand hills. I know all the fowls of the mountains, and the wild beasts of the field are mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell thee, for the world is mine, and the fullness thereof. Will I eat the flesh of bulls, or drink the blood of goats? Offer unto God thanksgiving, and pay thy vows unto the Most High, and call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me. Here the Lord rebuked them for their attitude in bringing their sacrifices. And He told them their sacrifices were not acceptable. We're told in 1 Samuel chapter 15. The reason why God rejected their sacrifices, and the reason why God rejects the commitment of the religious practices of some today, in 1 Samuel chapter 15, from verse 15. And Saul said, they have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and of the oxen to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God, and the rest were utterly destroyed. Then Samuel said unto Saul, stay, and I will tell thee what the Lord has said to me this night. And he said unto him, say on. And Samuel said, when thou wast little in thine own sight, was thou not made the head of the tribes of Israel? And the Lord anointed thee king over Israel. And the Lord sent thee on a journey, and said, go and utterly destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them until they be consumed. Wherefore then didst thou not obey the voice of the Lord, but didst fly upon the spoil, and didst evil in the sight of the Lord? I'm sure you would have read this story before. When Saul was humble, submissive to the will of God, when he was obedient and believing, the Lord called him and he gave him another heart. He had a change of life. And the Lord made him a king. But then he failed. You know why he failed? He took laws into his own hand. To start with, Samuel told him to wait for him 7 days, and at the seventh day he will come before they will go to fight in the battle. But as Saul waited for 6 days, on the seventh day he became impatient. For many people, impatience has ruined them. For many people, impatience has separated them from the Lord. Impatience in marriage, impatience in business, impatience in wanting to do something for the Lord, impatience in wanting to be known and recognized, and eventually he sacrificed. Immediately he finished his sacrifice, Samuel came and said, what have you done? You have done foolishly. That tells us that it is not just your sacrifice the Lord is looking for. It is not just your commitment or consecration the Lord is looking for. The Lord is looking for obedience to the totality and the finality of the Word of God. He wants you to take the Word of God as final. The Word of God says, sit down, sit down. And do not offer the sacrifice of a fool, the sacrifice of a rebellious person, the sacrifice of the disobedient. And eventually Samuel came and said, what have you done? Oh, he said, I saw that the people were scattering from me, and therefore I needed to sacrifice. Said, that sacrifice has not been accepted. You have behaved foolishly, and the Lord has rejected you. Many people have been rejected. They cannot do what they ought to do for the Lord. You know why? Because they're so much in a hurry. Because they are impatient. They cannot be obedient. They cannot be humble. They cannot be submissive to the will of God. And they are not following the Lord with trust and faith and confidence in the Lord alone. Now Saul was given a second chance. He was told to go and destroy the Amalekites. And he went. When he got there, he spared the sheep and the oxen, and he spared Agag, the king of the Amalekites. When Samuel came to him, you know the excuse he gave? He said, we have brought all these things back to sacrifice unto the Lord. He got into trouble again. He thought all that the Lord would be looking for is sacrifice without obedience, sacrifice without humility, sacrifice without submission to the will of God, sacrifice without faith. But that is always rejected before the Lord. In 1 Samuel chapter 15 verse 22. And Samuel said, as the Lord has great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. Do you know there are many people today, if you told them to pay tithes and offering, they'll give the tithe and they double each. But then, they are not obeying the voice of the Lord, they are still with the second woman. You know, there are many people today, if you told them to give money to the beggars, they will sacrifice. They will give money, they will give clothing, they will give food, they will give property to those who are in need. But then, they are disobedient. They cannot stop sinning. They continue in sin. And yet they can give their money, they can give property, and they can give anything. Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. You know, there are people that sacrifice a lot of time. They evangelize. They will preach in the bus. They will preach on the street corner. They will preach everywhere. They sacrifice a lot of time. They do a lot of running around for the gospel. But you know what? They cannot be obedient to the word of God. They are planning to marry an unbeliever. My friend, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. There are many people that do not understand that it is not just sacrifice. It is not just consecration. It is not just commitment. Our sacrifice or consecration or commitment must go along with humility, submission to the will of God, obedience to the word of God, and faith in the Lord. In Isaiah chapter 1. Isaiah chapter 1 from verse 10. Hear the word of the Lord, ye rulers of Sodom. Give ear unto the law of our God, ye people of Gomorrah. So what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me, says the Lord? I am full of burnt offerings of rams, and the fat of fed beasts. And I delight not in the blood of bullocks, and of lambs, or of he goats. When ye come to appear before me, who has required this at your hand, to tread my cause. Bring no more vain oblations. Incense is an abomination unto me. The new moons and Sabbaths, the calling of assemblies, I cannot away with. It is iniquity. Even the solemn meeting, your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hated. They are a trouble unto me. I am weary to bear them. And when you spread forth your hands, I will hide mine eyes from you. Yea, when ye make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. There are many people today, they think that all that the Lord is looking for is sacrifice. They go to the mountaintop to pray, but then sin is still in their hands. Their hands are full of blood. Don't they commit abortion? Don't they defraud? Don't they steal? Don't they cheat? Don't they lie? Don't they do evil? And yet they will be on the mountaintop they are praying. And God says, when you spread forth your hand, I will hide mine eyes from you. Why? Because your hands are full of blood. Isaiah was telling the children of Israel that he didn't want just offering of rams, or the killing of beasts, or the offering of bullocks, or the sacrificing of lambs, or the slaughter of he goats. He wanted them to repent. He wanted them to depend upon the Lord. He wanted them to be obedient and submissive to the will of God. Only then will their sacrifices be acceptable in the sight of the Lord. Today the Lord is telling the church the same thing. If you want to be acceptable in the sight of the Lord, and your commitment, your sacrifice, your consecration, your service, your worship, anything that you do for the Lord, make sure that you're obedient. Make sure that you are faithful. Make sure that you are submissive to the will of God. Make sure that you are following the Lord by faith. Look at verse 16. Wash you. Make you clean. Put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless and plead for the widows. Come now. And let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. The Lord is expecting that we do not just come with empty, shallow sacrifices. We come repenting, believing, obeying. In Matthew chapter 9, verse 13, Matthew chapter 9, verse 13. But go ye and learn what that meaneth. I will have mercy and not sacrifice. For I am not come to call the righteous, but the sinners unto repentance. The Lord reminded the children of Israel that their sacrifices did not worth anything, because they did not bring those sacrifices with faith, with humility, with repentance, with obedience, with submission to the will of God. Let's go back to Psalm 50, reading from verse 16. Psalm 50 from verse 16. But unto the wicked God said, what hast thou to do to declare my statutes, or that thou shouldest take my covenant in thy mouth, seeing thou hatest instruction and castest my words behind thee? God challenged the children of Israel. He said he did not want them to come near him if they were going to continue hating instruction, if they were going to continue casting his word behind them. There are a lot of people who hate the doctrines of the Bible, and yet they love to pray, and yet they love to fast, and yet they love to be religious, but they cast the commandment of God, the word of God, behind their back. In Proverbs chapter 28, Proverbs chapter 28 verse 9, he that turneth away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer shall be abomination. If you turn away your ear from the word of God, from the doctrines of the Bible, from the challenging, cleansing word of God, and if you refuse to hide that word in your heart and live by the standard of that word, even your prayer, even your sacrifice, even your worship will be abomination in the sight of the Lord. Isaiah chapter 58. Isaiah chapter 58 from verse 1. Cry aloud, spare not, lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgression, and the house of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me daily, and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness, and forsook not the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinances of justice. They take delight in approaching God. Can you see these people here? They will seek the Lord every day. Do you know there are people that go for prayer meeting every evening, and yet they refuse to be born again? Do you know there are people that go to the mountain to fast and pray every week or every month, and yet they refuse to be born again? Do you know there are people that will give a lot of money to the beggars, and yet they refuse to give their lives to the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you know there are people that will appear as if they were righteous, and yet they may have taken part in infant baptism? They may have taken part in what they call confirmation. They may have taken part in many ceremonies of church activity, and they are approaching unto the Lord every time, and yet they do not repent or turn away from their sins. And God says, what are such people to take my word in their mouth? What are such people to do to appear in my presence? Verse 3, wherefore have we fasted, say they, and thou seest not? Wherefore have we afflicted our soul, and thou takest no knowledge? Behold, in the day of your fast ye find pleasure, and exert all your labor. Come back to Psalm 50 verse 17. Seeing thou hatest instruction, and castest my words behind thee. If you hate the word of God, if you hate instruction, if you hate counseling, if you hate directives from the word of God, and you will not obey, what else, whatever else you may be doing, whatever else you may be sacrificing, will not be acceptable in the sight of God. Verse 19, Psalm 15. Thou givest thy mouth to evil, and thy tongue frameth deceit. Thou sittest and speakest against thy brother. Thou slanderest thine own mother's son. These hast thou done, and I kept silence. Thou thoughtest that I was altogether such an one as thyself. But I will reprove thee, and set them in order before thine eyes. Verse 18. When thou sawest a thief, then thou consentest with him, and has been partaker with adulterers. You know what these people did? They were godless in their manners. They connived at evil. They winked their eyes, they closed their conscience to evil. And they were partakers with evildoers, partakers with adulterers. They agreed or consented with robbers, with thieves. And God said, for such people, He will not have His mercy or His favor following after them. Proverbs chapter 24, verse 24. He that saith to the wicked, Thou art righteous, him shall the people curse. Nations shall abhor him. That means the people that take delight in the wicked people, they associate with the wicked people. The Lord says He will reject them. The Lord says even the people will curse them, and the curse will be effective upon them. What are we supposed to do if we want to have the favor of God upon our lives? Proverbs chapter 1, verse 10. My son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. If they say, come with us, let us lay wait for blood. Let us lock privily, privately. For the innocent without cause, let us swallow them up alive as the grave, and whole as those that go down into the pit. We shall find all precious substance, we shall fill our houses with spoil, casting thy lot among us. Let us all have one pulse. My son, walk not thou in the way with them, refrain thy foot from their path. If you want to be acceptable in the sight of the Lord, you must not be a partaker with adulterers, you must not consent with evildoers, with thieves and robbers. You must not be in agreement with the workers of iniquity or the workers of unrighteousness. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, 2 Corinthians chapter 6, from verse 14, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. What that means is that you will not be in business partnership with unbelievers that will lie, that will be dishonest, that will falsify account, that will defraud. You find that many people today, they defraud in their banks or in the places where they are working. And if you are a real Christian, if you want God to answer your prayers, if you want God to show you favor, you will not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers, unbelievers in your family circle. They may want you to be in agreement with them to sacrifice to idol. If you want God to answer your prayer, if you want to be a real child of God and not a backslider, you will not be in agreement with unbelievers to sacrifice to idol. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Of course, you know, there are people that say they are Christians and they are proposing to marry unbeliever. If you are a child of God, you will never give your hand in marriage to a person you know to be a sinner, a person you know to be a backslider, a person you know to be an evildoer. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion has light with darkness? What concord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them. Have you given promise that you are going to marry that unbeliever? But you have not married yet. You have not paid the dowry yet. And you have given your hand to that man. He says, if you want to make heaven, come out from among them. Are there people that are telling you that you should defraud and cheat and steal and join a gang of evildoers? Come out from among them. Are there people that you have promised that you will do evil with them? You will go the wrong way with them? If you want God to show favor upon you, it says, wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, says the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and I will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Let's look at 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 22. Lay hands suddenly on no man, neither be partaker of other men's sins. Keep thyself pure. You find people who are planning to do evil, keep yourself pure. Keep yourself separate. Lay hands suddenly on no man. Don't make friends suddenly with people. Know them, watch them, examine their lives. Be very sure they are children of God before you really become intimate with them. And if you are giving recommendation, sometimes some people say, I want you to recommend me. Recommend me to the bank. Recommend me to a place of work. Give me a testimonial that you have known me. Watch it. Make sure you know them before you give, when you put your hand on paper. Lay hands suddenly on no man. Neither be partaker of other men's sins. Somebody says, well, I want you to make recommendation for me. I've been a member of the church and is leaving the zone. Before you can send a recommendation to the church, for the church, for our office, write a letter from the headquarters office to where that fellow is going. Make sure you know the life of that person, so that you are not recommending somebody. You are not giving recommendation to anyone that is still living in secret sin, private sin. Lay hands suddenly on no man, and neither be partaker of other men's sins. Keep thyself pure. Sometimes it shocks me when I hear testimonies on Thursday. When somebody comes here and says, praise the Lord, I became born again. I joined this church 3 months ago. Now I am a worker. How did he become a worker? Without our knowing his life. There is somebody in the zone that has laid hands suddenly on that man, on that woman, and you will be partaker of his evil deed. If he does any havoc in the sin that you have given him to do, the blame, the judgment, the punishment, the damnation will be upon you. Lay hands suddenly on no man, neither be partaker of other men's sins. Keep thyself pure. Before you can get anybody involved in the work of God, before you can say, come on in the zone, be a standby worker. In the zone, be a person that, well, you may not be a regular worker yet, but we're looking up to you. You can do this, you can do that. And you begin to give them titles and labels. Make sure you know their lives. Make sure they're dependable. Make sure they're obedient to the word of God. Lay hands suddenly on no man. Neither be partaker of other men's sins. Keep thyself pure. You must watch it so that you are not recommending unbelievers and sinners to take part in the work of the Lord. Let's come back to Psalm 50. Psalm 50 from verse 22. Now consider this, ye that forget God, lest I tear you in pieces and there be none to deliver. Whoso offereth praise glorifies me. And to him that ordereth his conversation aright, will I show the salvation of God. The Lord has told us tonight that he reveals his majesty, his greatness, his might, his power. And it is to draw sinners unto himself, and also to make sure that believers will be able to look up to him and be reconciled unto him and be close to him. Those that have made covenant with God with sacrifice. Then I've shown you the people that reject the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of God. And the Lord is telling us that we are to follow him in repentance, in obedience, in humility, in submission to the will of God. And faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, the appointed Messiah. And you have seen the godless manners of people. The Lord is challenging us today that if we want his grace, his goodness, his might, power and majesty to be manifested in our lives, we should do as he has said. Let's rise up now and come to the Lord. Come to the Lord believing. Come to the Lord repenting. Come to the Lord giving all your heart, all your life unto him. And offer your life as a continual praise to the glory of God. And that you'll order your conversation and life aright. Let's talk to the Lord in prayer. That we will not be like the religious Jews that didn't know of the way of the Lord in the proper way. But that even though they were sacrificing, they didn't come to the Lord in the appointed manner. Come to the Lord in the appointed way. come to the Lord in the appointed manner. Offer yourself unto the Lord. Are you born again? Are you obedient to the word of God? What kind of sacrifices are you offering? Is it according to the laid down principles of righteousness in the word of God? Are you a partaker with evildoers? Are you compromising with sinners and backsliders? Are you submissive to the will of God? Are you obedient to the word of God? Are you following the Lord step by step? Are you separated from all evil? Or are you just religious without being righteous in the Lord? Are you one of the people of God? Following the Lord in God's appointed way? Have you offered yourself to the Lord? Live in a land that is praiseworthy. Let your light so shine. The people that know you and see you may glorify your Father who is in heaven.